I work at the Children's Hospital of Wisconsin. I had an oncology patient that impacted my life. She was so sweet. She had died of cancer, and I went to her funeral, and at her funeral, something had sparked. They had read a scripture about God has plans, and we don't get to know what they are, and we don't get to know why things happen. And it was very encouraging, and it sparked a little bit of faith. I was on my way home from work, so it was about 8 o'clock in the morning on a Sunday, and it's always packed here. I was just curious. Something had told me to stop, and I did. The first time that I was here, Pastor Brooks was teaching, and he had told everybody that those who are most disappointed in God are those who choose to not fully invest in God. So after that day, I started coming more and more to church. And then the last message of the series, Pastor Tom was teaching. And then at the end of his message, he had invited everybody up to the altar. And that is the day that I made my declaration to follow Christ. I have been more alive than I have been in my entire life. My eyes are open. I'm not going to let evil defeat me anymore.
So I want you to think back to when you were a kid, and there were probably 2 days out of the year that were your very favorite. My guess is they were Christmas and your birthday. Now, why were those 2 days so special to you? You knew that you were going to get gifts, and you were excited about it. And I was excited about it, and I still am. And so I want you to think, there was probably a favorite gift that you had received when you were a child, and it became your favorite possession. For me, it was a pair of Superman pajamas. And these weren't just pajamas. There was the belt and there was the cape. And so the excitement that I had opening this up, I truly believed when I slipped on these pajamas, I would transform into Superman. I thought I could fly. And so I remember climbing up on top of the dresser. I assumed the flying position, took a leap, and my parents got me a defective cape. I don't know what was up with that. So think of that favorite toy that you had. Maybe you hung on to it past the recommended age. For me, it happened when that belt no longer fit, and finally my wife said, "Hey, you're 39, you should stop wearing that. It's kind of creeping out the kids." Think of what your favorite toy was. What if today I could offer that to you, and I said, "Here you go. And I just want to make a trade with you. Take your favorite toy currently, and I will trade you for what was your favorite toy as a child." And you go, "Hey, we're adults now. We don't have toys." Oh, yes, we do. That thing that we work so hard for, that we save for, maybe it's golf clubs, a new cell phone, new computer, a bigger, a smarter TV, a boat, a different house, maybe a cabin, new car, a husband. Think about that favorite toy. And you would not make that trade, would you? You wouldn't make that trade because what you have now is more important to you. It's more valuable to you. It's probably more expensive. It's what you get more satisfaction out of. And it's not that that toy back then did not bring you lots of enjoyment, but it didn't bring lasting satisfaction. And that's true for all of us. We naturally get attached to things. They bring us so much joy. But it's like chewing gum. Eventually, we lose the flavor and we spit it out and we need another one. Did we know back then that that toy would stop being satisfying? You know, here's what's funny. When we look back, it's obvious there's going to be diminishing enjoyment. But we as human beings, we have a hard time seeing that looking forward to that thing we have yet to accomplish, we have yet to acquire. Can I tell you, let everything in your life that either currently brings so much joy or you're just looking to acquire it, one day is going to end up in a junkyard. We're in a series called More, and we're studying the book of Ecclesiastes and the life of a man named Solomon. And Ecclesiastes is kind of a weird name, but it simply means the preacher or the teacher. And it's written by Solomon in his older age. He was Israel's third king. He was the son of King David. He reigned during a very prosperous time. And if you've never heard anything else about Solomon, you've probably heard two things. You've heard about his wisdom, and you've heard about his wealth. You know, he was one of the smartest, wisest men to ever live. And the way this came about, he was about to become king, and God said, "You can ask me for anything." And Solomon says, "You know what? I'd like to be smart. I'd like to be wise. I'd like to be a great leader." And God was really impressed with that answer. So he says, "Yes, you're going to be a great leader. I'm going to give you wisdom. But that wisdom is also going to make you incredibly rich." And that is true. And so I want to put this in context. Bill Gates is currently worth $106 billion. Jeff Bezos is worth $113 billion. Solomon's estimated net worth in today's dollars, $2.2 trillion. That's 12 zeros. We know from one passage in 1 Kings 10, he had to build a fleet of ships to pick up a payment of gold that he was owed. So how would you like to call FedEx and say, "Hey, I need 5 semis because this guy owes me cash"? That's Solomon. And so when Solomon talks about success, when he talks about money, he knows what he's talking about, and we should really lean in. As Solomon was navigating life, he began to ask this question, "I wonder if I would be fulfilled if I had more?" Which is an interesting question because you and I have asked the very same thing. And so he begins this epic journey to find out which more could he acquire more of and find meaning and fulfillment. And so we'll begin today by reading Ecclesiastes 1:1. "The words of the teacher, son of David, king in Jerusalem, meaningless, meaningless," says the teacher, "utterly meaningless, everything is meaningless." Now, what you need to understand here, he's not saying that the things that he's acquired, the things that he's accomplished, were not enjoyable. He's not depressed. You might be thinking, why should I listen to this guy? It sounds like he's about to jump off the bridge. His problem is, he didn't know how to spend his money. I could show him how to spend $2.2 trillion and be happy. But that's not what he's saying. He's not saying he didn't enjoy himself. That word meaningless is the same word in Hebrew that means to take a breath. It just lasts a second, and it's over. What is meaningless, then, is at the end of it, there is no lasting significance. It was fun at the time. It just didn't last. Verse 3. "What do people gain from all their labor at which they toil under the sun? Generations come and generations go, but the earth remains forever. The sun rises and the sun sets and hurries back to where it rises. The wind blows to the south and turns to the north. Round and round it goes, ever returning on its course. All streams flow into the sea, yet the sea is never full. All the place the streams come from, there they return again." He's saying, hey, it's the weekend in Wisconsin and it's raining again. I don't know. Verse 8, "All things are wearisome, more than one can say. The eye never has enough of seeing, nor the ear its fill of hearing. What has been will be again. What has been done will be done again. There is nothing new under the sun. Is there anything of which one can say, 'Look, this is something new'? It was here already long ago. It was here before our time. No one remembers the former generations, and even those yet to come will not be remembered by those who follow them. This last verse is saying every generation comes along and says, hey, my parents, they didn't get it right. I'm going to do it different. I'm going to be radically individualistic, and we all do that the exact same way. And so we run after this, we run after that, we end up repeating the mistakes of our parents. And then one day we have kids and our kids think we did it all wrong. Verse 12, I, the teacher, was king over Israel and Jerusalem. I applied my mind to study and to explore by wisdom all that is done under the heavens. What a heavy burden God has laid on mankind. I have seen all the things that are done under the sun. All of them are meaningless, a chasing after the wind. What is crooked cannot be straightened. What is lacking cannot be counted. He's saying we live in a broken world, and there are things that are broken. They are wrong, and they will not be made right. Verse 16, I said to myself, look, I have increased in wisdom more than anyone who has ruled over Jerusalem before me. I have experienced much wisdom and knowledge. Then I applied myself to the understanding of wisdom and also to madness and folly. But I learned that this too is a chasing after the wind. For with much knowledge, with much wisdom comes much sorrow. With more knowledge, the more grief. And I think that's a powerful statement for us today, because we live in a culture that believes if we could just get educated, more knowledge, more technology, that we could overcome these problems. But that hasn't happened yet. Every time we outsmart one problem, then we get dumb in two others. And so as the book of Ecclesiastes go on, we see Solomon, he begins to chase more at every possible level. He begins to chase more in finances. He chases more with sex and with pleasure. And here's what we're going to zoom in on today. He begins to chase more in accomplishment, hoping that at some level that could finally bring fulfillment to his life. He chases more in work. He said, maybe if I could be a success, maybe if I could be a part of something that changed the world and helped others, maybe if I did enough, in the end, that would end up being fulfilling. And here's his conclusion. There is not enough success. There is nothing about work that in the end has the ability to make your life fulfilling and meaningful. And that's really unsettling for us, because here in the United States, where we have an emphasis on being a success, his answer just kind of unhinges some of the truths that we've believed about life. And there's some of us here this morning, this is where we have placed our more. This is the thing that we thought, if I could just work for that company, if I could just get the corner office, if I could land that deal, if I could simply get the promotion, that would be enough to bring fulfillment and meaning to my life. And we have become obsessed with work. And Gallup does a poll, and they say, no matter where your income level is, they ask the question, what would you need to finally be, I'm good, I'm at rest. And whatever you make, it's always just slightly over double. If you make 30-some thousand, you'd say, I need 74,000, then I would be good. There's people in this room that make more than that, and you say, you know what? No, I'm not rich. I need twice that. Ladies, many of you feel the tension between the work of your home and working outside of the home. In 1950, 33% of women were in the workforce. Today, that number is 57%. And many have thought, this seems to be the thing that matters. And so maybe if I had a career, that would bring more fulfillment to my life. And what do we say to our kids? We say, find something that you are passionate about and then do that. And isn't there just a subtle underlying statement there that if you could only work in something you're passionate about, by doing that, you could find fulfillment in your work? And yet Solomon, he has a completely different answer for us. And so the wisest man who ever lived, here's what he has to say about work in our lives. Ecclesiastes 2:17. He says, so I hated life because the work that is done under the sun was grievous to me. All of it is meaningless, a chasing after the wind. And that phrase, under the sun, simply means just everything that the sun touches. And what Solomon wants you to know is, look, this isn't that I had the wrong job. I wasn't in a dead-end job. I was the king, and I tried every possible thing, every type of work at every level to try to find meaning and fulfillment in my life. Verse 18, I hated all the things I had toiled for under the sun, because I must leave them to the one who comes after me. And who knows whether that person will be wise or foolish? Yet they will have control over all the fruit of my toil, of which I have poured my effort and skill under the sun. This too is meaningless. And last week, my dad taught on this, that the moral of the story is spend all your money. Don't leave any of it to your kids. It's apparently what I have to look forward to. Verse 20. So my heart began to despair over all my toilsome labor under the sun. For a person may labor with wisdom, knowledge, and skill, and then they must leave all they own to another who has not toiled for it. This too is meaningless and a great misfortune. What do people get for all the toil and anxious striving at which they labor under the sun? All their days, pay attention, their work is grief and pain, and even at night their minds do not rest. This too is meaningless. When you decide to make work the center of your universe, that this is what I'm going to extract fulfillment and meaning from, then even when you're not working, even when you're at home and you should be at rest, your mind is going 1,000 miles a minute. You're churning over work. And here's my guess. There are people in this room, you have been successful at your work. There's some people here, you have been very successful. And my guess is you worry more about work now than before you were successful. And so what does that say about the power of work to bring fulfillment? Verse 24, a person can do nothing better than to eat and drink and find satisfaction in their own toil. This too I see is from the hand of God, for without him, who can eat or find enjoyment? Solomon says, look, work is not bad. Work is actually a good thing in our lives, but it becomes destructive when it is misunderstood and misused. You and I were made to accomplish something. When we get the graduation, when we get the promotion, there is a level of satisfaction that we have, but that satisfaction is short-lived. And so we begin to say, what if I could just add more satisfaction to satisfaction? What if I could get the next promotion, the next raise? Maybe eventually that could accumulate and then translate into fulfillment for me. And so we say the answer must be more work and more work and more work. If I could just accomplish more, if I could just be promoted, if I could be recognized, if my income could increase. And then we say more and more could actually fulfill that thing that is missing and undone in me. Now, here's what you need to know. I'm not saying that work is bad. Matter of fact, Scripture says work is good. Think about this. The very first time we open up the Scriptures, Genesis 1, what do we see? God is at work. He's creating the universe. And then God creates Adam, and he sets him in a garden. And this is before the fall. And he puts them to work, in which now every teenager says, this is a bad sermon. There's a part of us that was built to work, to contribute, to bring something that has value and helpfulness to the world. But the problem is when we misuse work, when we try to make it fulfill that void in our life, that's where we get off track. Years ago, I woke up one morning and there had been just a lot of snow during the night. And so I go out to my car, it's in the driveway, and it's covered with about a foot of snow. And so I know I have a little scraper inside of the car, and I'm like, that's going to take forever. Plus, when I open up the car door, there'll be an avalanche in. So I thought, I know what I'll do. There's a shovel in the garage. I will just take that shovel, I'll shovel off the car, I'll be on my way in no time. There's only one problem with that idea. The shovel was made of metal. Anybody have any idea what my car looked like when I was done clearing off the car? It had a nice zebra pattern. Here's the thing. There was nothing wrong with the shovel, and there's nothing wrong with the idea of clearing off the car, but when you take something and you use it for a purpose it was not intended for, and then all of a sudden it becomes really expensive and damaging. This is what Solomon says to you and I. Don't take work and make it something it was never intended to be. And the truth is that longing in your soul that looks for eternity, for fulfillment and meaning, can never be fulfilled with more work. It wasn't designed to do that in your life. And so that leaves us with the logical question then, what is work good for? What can it do for me? And Solomon lets us know in this passage, verse 24, this is why work is positive. He says, a person can do nothing better than to eat and drink and find satisfaction in their own toil. This too I see is from the hand of God. Scripture says you can find great satisfaction from your work. You just can't find fulfillment and meaning. But when you do a job well, when you do something that makes a difference, you can be satisfied you are a part of that. It's a teacher who says, you know what, in my classroom, I am shaping kids for the rest of their lives, and it doesn't matter what happens outside of this classroom or in their home, I have a chance to set them up for success. It's the engineer who says, you know what, I was a part of that group, it was my solution that was adopted, and I take great satisfaction in that. Solomon says that's what work was intended to do in your life. But there are some things that work can never, ever do for you. The first thing is this: work can never establish your worth. Your job and how well you do it can never establish your worth. You go, well, this is church, of course. We all know that, right? Really? I want to say it again because that is completely countercultural. Your work can never establish your worth. You doubt me, you can walk into a room, us men. What is the very first question we will ask another man? What do you do? And the moment that other man says, this is my employment, this is what I do, we would never say this out loud, but what happens in our minds is we immediately put them on a scale. We assess value based on what they do. And so in that moment, the other person says, well, I'm a doctor. Oh, that's impressive. Or I'm a lawyer. Well, I have mixed feelings about that. We immediately assess value. It's intuitive. And ladies, you also experience this, but sometimes the conversation is a little different in female circles. What every woman will ask another woman is, are you married? And then if that's established, then often the next question is, do you have children? And so intuitively, we make these value statements, and man, if she's an old maid, I mean, she's 23 or older, it's like, wow. We assess a value statement. Oh, you don't have kids immediately. And what you need to hear, Solomon says, your worth, your value can never be established by what you do. And so whether you're a mother or an electrical engineer, your value is not established by what you do. Your value has already been predetermined by a cross. The fact that Jesus Christ was willing to pay that price, and what's even more radical is if you were the only one who said, I will accept him, I will follow him. Jesus says, that is the price I'm willing to pay. Work can never do that. It can never establish your worth. But the second thing work can never do is it can never bring fulfillment. It can bring satisfaction, but it can never truly bring fulfillment to my life. I can never get to the end of a workday, and more importantly, I can never get to retirement and an end of career and say, ah, that's why I'm here. That's why God created me. Because work was never built to do that. You know how we get confused by this? We have a pretty good day at work, or maybe we have a pretty good year at work, and it feels like I've accomplished something. And so we say, well, maybe if I just take it up to the next level and I accomplish the next thing and I stretch myself some more, take on this new venture, and we believe that will finally get us across the line where that is fulfilling for life. And the only reason we believe that is because we've not achieved it yet. Now, how many of you are familiar with dog racing? How many of you bet on dog racing? Okay. So it's kind of a thing of the past, but what they would do is they would take greyhounds and they would put them each in a chute. They'd have the gatelets closed, and just ahead of them, there would be a rabbit. And so at once, all the gates would open and these greyhounds would race towards the rabbit around the track, and we would bet on who crossed the line first. Now, here's the thing that you could never, never, never let happen. You cannot let the dog actually reach the rabbit because the rabbit is not real. It's mechanical. It's just a piece of metal that is painted. And once that dog has reached that rabbit, that dog is no longer good for racing. That dog will say, "What am I chasing this for?" And so then the next time the gates will open, all the other dogs will race off, and that dog will just stay where he's at. And like, I think I'm going to sniff some other dogs instead. I'm not going to chase a rabbit that's not a rabbit. You know why you and I, we still chase the rabbit? Why we still think that work or more success or that promotion will fulfill us? Because we haven't caught the rabbit yet. And Solomon says, listen, listen to me. I caught the rabbit. I went after more and more and more, and I accomplished more and accumulated more. And he says, it's a metal rabbit, and it doesn't fulfill. You want to know the secret about our work that will change work for us? And it doesn't matter what you do, whether you're on the janitor team, you're an engineer, you're a nurse. It's not about what you do, it's about who you do it for. It's not about what you do, it's about who you do it for. Colossians 3:23. Whatever you do, work at it with all your heart as working for the Lord, not for human masters. Since you know that you will receive an inheritance from the Lord as a reward, it is the Lord Jesus, the Lord Christ, you are serving. I think some of the tone in the book of Ecclesiastes is due to the fact that Solomon, he's looking on his life and he says, yes, I've accumulated a lot, I've had success, I've had great experiences, but I don't know if I have much in terms of reward. So a lot of us in the church have gone on missions trips at various times, and the work that we do on missions trips is often pretty ordinary, simple tasks that we probably do here at home. And so in LA this past summer, it was picking up trash in the neighborhood, it was working in the kitchen there, and so some of us were emptying trash cans and like washing the walls of the kitchen and the dining area. Some of us just pots and pans. Some of us serving these meals to people that people were not very excited to eat. And then at the very end of our shift, the manager of the kitchen, her name was Kelsey, she said, hey, I want everyone to come around the table. I need to talk to you. And so she began to share how she was homeless and she had a child. And so they were out on the streets. She was addicted to drugs and her life was just spiraling out of control. And it was here in this place, in this kitchen, she came to know Jesus Christ. And her life's been changed, and she began to tell the stories of the other people working in the kitchen. And that really became the highlight of the trip. That was, this is who we're working for. This is why we're doing what we're doing. You see, none of the other jobs on that trip had changed from that day, but suddenly everything was different. And it's never about what you do. It's about who you do it for. And I'm just going to say, Jesus is an incredible boss, right? He always has your best interests at heart. He knows how you thrive. He will bring the appropriate amount of challenge and stretching to you. And so here's the challenge as we leave today, that you would go to work tomorrow and you're going to have the same job. You're going to have the same supervisor. There's going to be the same tediousness. There are going to be the same things that are not fulfilling about what you do. The pay will still not be enough. You'll be underappreciated. Nothing is going to change. But if you go to work tomorrow and you remember, I'm not working trying to get fulfillment, but I'm working for the Lord. I'm going to allow God to work through me today. I'm going to allow God to make some people around me curious as to why I have joy in the job. Maybe God could be famous at that workplace. You go to work tomorrow, probably nothing's going to change, but everything will be different. Because it's not about what you do, it's about who you do it for. That is the secret of work. And I just want to take a moment. We're going to pray, and then the worship team will lead us in a new song this morning. But let's just take a moment. And let's begin just with a heart of gratitude. Lord, we thank you for the jobs that we have. Lord, thank you for the ability to work. And Lord, that you have given it. It's a gift. Lord, it allows us to see how you've uniquely made us, Lord, our passions, our abilities. Lord, thank you. You've placed us, Lord, where we can go in every direction and find people to hire us. And so, Lord, we just say thank you. God, thank you for the job you've given to us. Lord, we say thank you for the provision, Lord, that that job provides. And Lord, you are a good and perfect Heavenly Father. And so that income, that salary is not random. It's not by chance. You, in your wisdom and in your grace towards us, have said, this is my provision for you. And for that, we say thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you for providing. Would you take a moment right now and just pray for your supervisor, the person that you report to? Lord Jesus, would you bless them? Lord, would that workplace, would that school tomorrow, Lord, be extra blessed, Lord, because I bring your presence into that place? Lord, would my supervisor's life be made easier and better, Lord, because of how I do my job? Lord Jesus, as we go into our workplace, Lord, and for all those who they work in their home, and that is so important, God, would you give them that grace and strength? We're not working for anyone but you. Our direct report is you. And Lord Jesus, you are an incredible boss. And it's our joy to work for you for the rest of our lives. God, may the way that I work, God, and the reason why I work, God, may it bring joy. And God, may it point people to you. I pray your favor, your anointing on each person here. And we pray this all now in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Would you please stand with me? I'm going to invite our prayer team to come forward. If you've come here with a request, let's join together in faith that that need will be met. And our worship team is just going to lead us in a new song today about seeking more with God. He has abundantly more.